Okay, everyone. Well, good afternoon, or good morning, or good evening, depending on from which time zone you are tuning in from. My name is Jess Roman, and you are viewing the Berlin Epidemiological Methods Colloquium, our very last BEMP talk of the year. So thanks for being here for this one. We're really excited about today's talk. Before I introduce our speaker today, I just want to give a few short announcements about our colloquium. So we are planning, busily planning our sessions for 2022. You can find the information in the next couple of days on our website, but we will continue as planned on Wednesdays at 4 p.m., the first Wednesday of the month. At 4 p.m. Berlin time, and then we will still run our journal club the third week of the month. Everyone is welcome to join, and we'll post the link to our website in the chat in case you are not yet familiar with us. So basically what we're doing in these BEMP talks, we invite a speaker who inspires us, and we listen to them talk with us for 45 minutes or so, sometimes a bit longer, sometimes a bit shorter, and then we open up the round for discussion and for your questions. So feel free to already post those in the Q&A. There's a little button at the bottom of your screen. So if you click that button, you can type a question. You can also upvote other questions that you like. And I, if there's something really urgent, may interrupt Cecile during her talk and I'll ask the question. Otherwise, we'll wait to the end. And actually at the end, we've already had some of you volunteer to join us up here on the panel. We really appreciate that. If anyone else would like to, you just need to raise your hand at the end of the talk and we'll promote you to a panelist and you can come on here with audio and or video. We'll turn off the recording at that point and have hopefully a nice fruitful discussion. The other folks up here are all from the Institute of Public Health. We have Chisato Ito, Tobias Kurt, and Toivo Glatz at the moment, who will join in the discussion later as well. Hopefully I'm not forgetting anything, otherwise I'll write it in the chat. And now I'd like to introduce today's speaker. We are very, very honored to wrap up our year 2021 with Professor Cecile Janssens from Emory University, the Rowland School of Public Health in Atlanta in the US. She's a professor of translational epidemiology and studies the implications of genomic research in clinical practice and on a population level. And her research, as you can tell by the talk's title, mostly focuses on the prediction domain. So we've dabbled in a lot of causal inference as well as some prediction this year in the BEMP. So we're happy to come back to the topic of prediction. And she's currently writing a book on the science behind the news. So she's busy doing that. She's very active on Twitter and posts a lot of really interesting content. So if you don't follow her, we'll post her Twitter link in the chat as well. Okay, hopefully I didn't forget anything. Without further ado, Cecile, thanks again and over to you.
Thank you so much. Yes, this is really an honor to talk to you today, to present here this, this talk. It's a bit of, at the end of the year, a bit of an end of the year reflections that I I'm thinking of a lot. This is a great opportunity to share them. So the title of my talk is Prediction, Predictability, and Priorities. And I the focus will be on why is it that so much of our research, of the research that's being done on prediction, just doesn't make it to bedside. And I think, well, let me not say what I think about it. You hear it at the end. So this is the fastest road from bench to bedside. It's a road that as soon as you leave the city of Atlanta, there's almost nothing. This is just on a weekday, my route to the south. So most of my observations, they come from 15 years of research on polygenic risk scores. I started that work in 2004. It's highly popular at these days. I lost a bit of my interest, and I'm going to, and it has all to do with the predictability of disease. And I'm going to share my observations today. Before I start my talk, I always would like to share a few of my, you know, the background of my work. So what motivates my work is has everything to do with utility. So what we do in health research is ultimately for the people that are waiting for our results. And this is my family. So it's a, you know, most of my work is on genetic prediction. This is the family of my mom. And this is my mom when I was, this is me, when I was a few years old. My mom died of breast cancer. And so my hereditary risk of cancer is really what drives me in this work, but also what continues me to emphasize that what we need to make sense and have purpose. So there are people out there, my family members, and also now this, my generation, my cousins and me, who want to know about our risks of future disease. And so we should not waste the time of the people who want to have our implications, and we don't waste them time when we do our research to the best of our abilities. And unfortunately, I think that's often not the case. So that is my big motivator. So everything I do is driven by utility. So that's also the obvious goal of prediction. Prediction is the goal of prediction research, in my view, is about utility, because we don't do prediction research to study risk factors. That is epidemiology. We start our risk models with risk factors or with associated variants in genetic prediction that we know already. So if we build risk scores that based are of hundreds of risk genetic variants that are associated with disease, we should not be surprised that we find that a polygenic risk score or a risk model is also statistically significantly associated with disease, because that's how we build it. And so that is what I do often see in the research, that is really focusing on the statistical significance of the association that then is being interpreted as being predictive, and that the intended use on how we are going to use that information is totally out of sight. So for me, everything I do is with the utility in the background, but also knowing that that people out there, including myself when I'm a patient, don't care about minor differences in risk. So I don't, you know, I'm not really increased motivation when my risk of breast cancer changes from 20 to 24%. That doesn't matter. So I did my thesis. I'm a psychologist by training, and my PhD thesis was on risk perception. So I did risk perception before I did risk prediction. And from that, I know that really, if you ask the people, they have, they think about the world as maybe very low risk, medium risk, high and very high, and that is the level of precision that they need to make their decisions. And what we see a lot in at least in polygenic risk research is that people overinterpret very, very small changes in the area under the curve or in risks as being predictive or having added value for clinical practice. That is not what the people need. It is about the risks. First of all, they need to If we want to motivate health behavior or have clinical utility, then these small changes are not enough. We need to make bigger differences when we make better risk models for healthcare. And they, in my view, they need to be understandable. We can't ask people to trust a complex model and say you have an increased risk of breast cancer. You know, people need to understand why that risk is increased. And that is why I always go for the simplest possible model, and then that's a scientific question. When is it still valid enough to as a model? But I would like to go for simple, that people understand why their risk is increased and then act on it. Views and observations that guide today's presentation. I'm often projected as a skeptic when it comes to polygenic risk prediction. I'm not sure I agree with that myself. I think I'm a realist, and I just watch the science closely. There is just not enough reason to be very optimistic about it. And that was already as soon as Francis Collins and others around 2000 started touting about the how genetics might revolutionize medicine, there were already, you know, contrary views, not only by me, but I wasn't in the field at that time, but that say, no, it's not that easy, you know, to really, from genetic associations to translate them to practice. This paper influenced me a lot. And this is my early study that I did together with Ewout Steierberg and colleagues. This was one of my first papers on polygenic risk prediction before it was called polygenic risk prediction or polygenic risk scores. In 2006, before the genome-wide association studies really had to take off, we wrote a paper based on simulated data. I will reflect on that later on, where we basically showed what is needed if we want to create polygenic risk scores when will they be very predictive and will not? So it is, we use a formula, and that formula is filled with the, you know, we enter data in it. And so what kind of genetic associations do we need to make the model very predictive? And then from that moment on, you can reason, okay, if this is what I need to make it very predictive, is this realistic? Can I expect such strong associations? I come back to that in a minute. So this paper is really was so very impactful that I say, you know, you can really know in advance what you can expect of a risk model. And other views, you know, that was also very much a reality. We have seen so much optimism already in prediction, not only in genetic prediction, but this is about genetics. There have been companies all over the board. There are companies now that try to see whether we can we can predict future health for people. But those companies have always been there, starting already at the very early days before the GWAS, and then with 23andMe, of course, after the GWAS. And most of those companies are just gone, except for 23andMe. So this is also a business that comes and goes. You know, people see opportunities, then they realize that they are not there, and then the companies close again. So it has been this reality, so that people are now very optimistic about polygenic risk prediction. That is totally fueled, I would say, by this paper here on the upper left by Kira and colleagues, who claimed a few years ago that the genomite polygenic risk scores for common diseases, they can point to people who have a risk that is as high as for monogenic mutations. And they compare it with monogenic mutations, because we do monogenic testing for monogenic mutations already in healthcare for over decades. And so if that is useful, is their reasoning, then the polygenic risk scores will be useful as well. And this really fueled the field again after years of, you know, there was not so much hope, especially so around, I would say, 2010, 2015. When I just moved to Atlanta to really, you know, move my work up on polygenic risk research, that really the field was imploding, but this revived it again with a differently framed message that is not really supported by the science. So the optimism, this has definitely put a lot of people back into research, with a lot of big claims also in the media. But the question is the science there behind it up to par? Just to give you a little bit of a view, you know, what are we talking about when I'm talking about polygenic risk? This is the one slide tutorial about it. So what we know already for many years, decades, is that we have monogenic forms of disease, or polygenic familial forms of disease, where a mutation in a gene causes the disease. And for our poster example for that is Huntington disease, where people who carry a mutation, you see that here on the lower left, when people carry a mutation in the Huntington gene, they have 100% probability that they will develop the disease during their life. And when they don't carry it, the probability is zero. So it's really all or nothing. It's totally genetically explained. But also for familial breast cancer and familial colorectal cancer, there are variants out there, mutations out there, that really have an enormous increase in the risk of the lifetime risk of disease. But the people who don't carry this mutation still have other causes, you know, for their illness. So, but it is these big differences that makes it clinical utility, and that makes it why clinical genetics is a field, and why people want to get tested when the disease runs in their family. When we think about multifactorial or complex diseases, it's not one genetic mutation. Actually, we don't call them mutation anymore. They call variations or polymorphisms. It's variations in our DNA that when you have one allele, one variant, then your risk may be a bit higher. And when you have the other variant, maybe a bit lower, but it's more in all contributing to your susceptibility and not, you know, not determining whether you get ill. And so for most complex diseases and traits, it is tens or hundreds or thousands of variants that are implicated. And the idea with polygenic risk scores is then if we combine, here you see the three earliest variants for type 2 diabetes, not on their own, not enough big risk difference between people who carry the the risk alleles and who don't carry them. But what if you combine them, not three of them, but hundreds of them into a score? Can you then identify people who are at much higher risk of, for example, type 2 diabetes? And that is what polygenic risk is about. So here's a very simple example. In a study of 40,000 people, where they investigated, where they knew about 10 polymorphisms implicated in colorectal cancer, and where they created a polygenic score based on those 10 variants. Okay, when you have 10 polymorphisms, and for each you can have 0 or 1 or 2 risk alleles, depending on how many you get from your parents. You either get 0 from your parents, 1 either from your father or your mother, or you get them both. You can have a score, an unweighted score, a simple sum score that goes from 0 to 20 risk alleles. 0 if you get nothing, 20 if you get all risk alleles from on all these 10 genes. That is how we did it in the early days. Just summing up, you know, for each individual in the study, how many of those variants do you have? The weighted risk score makes it, now for us, I think, not so much more difficult, not more complicated, but there we basically multiply the risk allele first with the coefficient, with the weight, to create a weighted risk score. And this is now being done for hundreds and thousands and even millions of genetic variants, but the principle behind it is still the same. It's just multiplying the number of risk alleles by their beta coefficient. And what you see here then is, if you do that for an entire population, you see you get a distribution of a score. Here it's an unweighted risk score for cases and controls in that study. And here you see that the distribution for the cases is slightly moved to the right towards having more risk alleles than and the controls slightly to the left. But there's much overlap here in the distributions. And so what you want with prediction is that these two risk distributions, or these scores, or even if you don't do genetics, but just for clinical risk models, you can also make distributions like this. You want to have those distributions too much separated. And here you see an example for the polygenic risk score, an unweighted risk score for type 2 diabetes. Here you see a risk model for age-related macular degeneration that does not include only genetic variants, but also clinical risk factors. And then you see that the score, the difference is that when you use a score like this for clinical care, you ultimately need a cutoff score somewhere that says above a certain threshold, based on a score or a risk model, those are the people I will treat and those are the people that I will not treat. And so that is why the separation of these distributions is so essential, because when they are more separated, you treat more people for the right reasons and you withhold treatment also more often for the right reasons. And the separation of these two curves, that is the area under the curve. And so the area under the curve is nothing more, but also nothing less than this difference. And for a model to be predictive, you need to have this separation. That the AUC is nothing more or nothing less than the risk distributions is what we showed last year in this paper, where we basically showed that if you start with the risk distributions and transform the axis several times, you get the ROC plot. So that's what we are looking at. Well, how do you get a higher area under the curve? So that is by filling it with variants or with risk factors, with predictors that have a stronger impact on disease risk. And this is from our paper in 2006, where we studied that for genetic variants. So here we didn't call them polymorphisms, we simply call them genes. And what we did is we created in simulated data risk models for up to 400 genetic variants. And then for each of the models, we said, okay, what will be the area under the curve if you have a risk model that has so many variants? We had a certain allele frequency for that, but if this is your per allele odds ratio. And here we showed that, of course, first of all, if you add more variants from the same strength, at one point the area under the curve is plateauing, but that you really need a lot of variants of stronger effect to get a higher AUC. We also showed that, okay, what if these here in this scenario on the left, we assume that all the risk variants into the model up to 400 all had the same per allele odds ratio, but what now? What if you have a few variants here, this is also up to 400 variants, a few variants that have a really much stronger effect, like a threefold increase in risk or twofold increase in risk, and the rest of your variants are all this lower per allele odds ratio. Then we also show that if you have a few variants with a stronger effect, that really boosts the predictive ability of a model. It's really, if you have a few variants that have an odds ratio of 3, you easily get a much higher area under the curve. And these examples exist. Age-related macular degeneration, for example, is in this boat. But if all your variants have very, very small effect, then It's very unlikely that your area under the curve gets much higher than 0.60, 0.65 based on genes alone. And so that was the paper that we at that point wrote, basically showing that if you want a genetic model, polygenetic score with a higher discriminative accuracy, you need a few predictors that are not too rare and that have really strong effect. So that's what this paper showed. That it is possible. So it is not a pessimistic view, but it basically outlines, you know, when does a model get predictive? And so that is not only happens when the variants are genetic, because, you know, our computers, our software doesn't know whether the variables that we are putting in the model are genetic or non-genetic. It happens all the time. They only see the strength of effect and the frequency of exposure. And when you know this, you can also think about, you know, for what scenario is it likely that we can expect, you know, variants with stronger effect? And that helps thinking, okay, for which diseases can we expect that polygenic risk will make a difference, and for which it becomes unlikely. And this is a more just a practical illustration, indeed, that you do get higher AUC when you have at least a few variants with strong effect. This is an older example from type 2 diabetes, where the strongest per allele odds ratio for TCF7L2 was really a weaker predictor than, you know, here for hypertriglyceridemia, the weakest predictor had a twofold increased risk. And when you have multiple variants with a stronger effect, when they are not too rare, you get a much higher area under the curve. And of course, I am well aware that high AUC is not enough. You know, it is in prediction. So there's a lot of focus in polygenic risk these days on the area under the curve, but of course it's not enough. We need to also show that the model calibrates well, that it validates well in external populations, and that there is clinical utility, that it's really worth doing this test. But from my view, the area under the curve is the first step, you know, to telling, you know, whether, you know, further research into the utility might be worth it. You know, if the area under the curve is very, very low, then I would not choose that to see whether this very low area under the curve might be useful in healthcare. Mm-hmm. There are some exceptions, especially when you have a very rare risk factor, a rare variant. That may be very that is very predictive for a small group of the patients that will not improve the AUC that much, but most of the time for common diseases with common variants, common risk factors, this is a rule of thumb that helps me at least selecting in which applications am I really interested in, or when is just this, you know, when are risk models not predictive enough to make a difference. Because also clinical utility, demonstrating clinical utility is not alone and not enough on its own. So it is, this is a framework that they developed almost two decades ago for the evaluation of genetic tests. It is not only, you know, whether a test will be implemented in healthcare, it's not only whether the test, you know, whether the test has good analytic validity when you can reliably assess your risk factors, not only when it has good enough clinical validity, and not even when there are effective interventions. You need to introduce the model in healthcare. You need to have the facilities. You need to train your people. You need to have to educate also the population. It needs to be worth it. It needs to be an economic evaluation showing that indeed the health benefits outweigh the health risks. And there is so much more research that need to follow our work on the predictive ability that always makes me very humble if I see a framework like this, saying that really the improvement that I am going to generate with adding my new risk factor to a test, or with introducing, for example, a polygenic risk score, the added value of my in predictive ability needs to be worth it, that you know, that all these extra things that you need to arrange to introduce in healthcare are worth it. And we don't do that for just a statistically significant improvement in the area in the curve of 0.01. You know, that is just not worth all this organization. So the improvement needs to be substantial to be worth it in practice. So that is what I always keep in mind, you know, so that I select on the area under the curve, knowing that this is the whole trajectory that needs to follow. So why do I think that most of the research, at least in polygenic risk, is not making it to practice and not even close? And that is because I see a huge gap between what doctors want. At the one hand, they want to make, they are used to making decisions about screening, prevention, and diagnosing treatment based on incomplete information, sometimes even on poor information, sometimes even on very little information. And they would love to see, to have more tools to do a better job in making more better decisions. But what I see, especially in the research of polygenic risk research, you know, the data analysts, it's not even the epidemiologists, it's not even the prediction researchers. These days, it's a lot of bioinformatics researchers who do all kinds of risk scores and complex algorithms, make it very complicated, where that they say that they can improve prediction by all kind of new variables, new data. But what there is a big gap between them. So what the researchers are creating in terms of risk scores is not what the doctors could use, because there is very little communication between those two fields. And I did myself, I made mistakes myself too. So I thought, let me share a paper that I wrote that I supervised in 2008, published in Diabetes, cited over 200 times, I think. It's a great paper. So it is a study, one of the first on type 2 diabetes prediction, for which we use a very large cohort study in Rotterdam, and we investigated whether an unweighted risk score could predict type 2 diabetes, incident type 2 diabetes alone and beyond age, sex, and BMI. And so this has been a very basic summary. So we basically found that the genetics on its own didn't predict very well, but also didn't add that much to prediction based on age, sex, and BMI. So that was our conclusion in those days. I remember this as a study, you know, it was, you know, to our credit, this was one of the first studies that combined polygenic risk scores and an unweighted risk score with clinical variables, and showed how you can do that in a cohort study. But it was useless. The study is useless from a public health perspective, because this population on average is the Rotterdam study. They are 70 years of age on average at baseline. That is not your typical population when you want to investigate whether you can improve the screening for type 2 diabetes and identify risk groups based on polygenic risk. That is not the population that you would like to target. You would like to target people way younger, you know, before all the damage of their unhealthy lifestyles, etc., is done. Also, this was early days, there were many more genetic variants to be expected. So our results literally were already obsolete soon after publication. So we worked hard to get it out there. But as soon as we published it, there were already more variants. And these more variants, of course, kept on creating the promise that the prediction could be better. This was an early snapshot, a little bit skeptic, a little bit pessimistic, but the GWAS started in 2007 to produce our results. This was only the beginning. And also here I cannot even figure out in the paper anymore, you know, what our risk period was, because we had very variable follow-up time. It was totally unclear prediction. But most of it, what I'm saying is the population was too old, not relevant from a public health perspective. And with that, I could have saved that work, or, you know, I should have done my proof of principle in a population that was more relevant for public health. And that's what we see too often. Too often we see that researchers, especially these days, especially in polygenic risk, massively they use the UK Biobank for their prediction. And that is not your ideal population that is representative for the future scenario where you want to implement those risk scores. And this is one lesson that I always share with my students. It does matter in which population you investigate your prediction model, genetic or non-genetic. This is a study by Lubitz et al. From a few years ago, where they investigate how the polygenic risk score could improve the prediction of atrial fibrillation. And what they do here, they have five different populations. They investigate the same clinical risk score and a model that it considers the clinical risk score and the polygenic risk score in five different populations, exact same model. Here are the characteristics of the study population. Just in short, different countries, that's not so big of a deal, different setup. So some are population or community based, others, one study is a hospital database and the other one an RCT. Different use of baseline, but here's what I would like to focus on. These studies differed a lot in how old the people were in the study. Here they have an age range from 28 to 75, here a more narrow age range, here a totally not reported age range. And the follow-up time is also variable, not specified in most of the papers, or here a very short one. And why does that matter? If you look at the age range and you look at the natural history of atrial fibrillation, atrial fibrillation doesn't happen when you are at a young age. The people at the young age, they don't get atrial fibrillation that develops. You've developed that later on in life. So if we then put, you know, these ages of the age distribution of the populations here on this graph, you see that a few studies really are covering this entire an entire range here, but that the last study really only has a very short range. But what happens when you include people from 28 to 75, and even say you have, even when you have a 20-year follow-up time, I do not know how long it was in that study, the people who are in the younger range, they will also within 20 years not develop atrial fibrillation, whereas the people at the higher age, they are more likely to develop atrial fibrillation. So by definition, a population with a wide age range will have a much higher AOC. That's what you expect when you put age in the model. And that's also what we see here. So in MESA, this, the three studies that really had a very wide follow-up time, a very wide age range, these three colors, they have a much higher AUC for the clinical model than, for example, PROSPER with a very, very narrow age range, because when the more narrow the age range, the less the impact of age, and so the lower your area in the curve. And that is what worries me so much in this massive use of the UK Biobank, where the age range is, I think, from 35 to 70 or so, 65. All these models come out very, very well with a high area under the curve, but it's essentially because we are looking at the UK Biobank has a 10-year follow-up at this time. So we are looking at a short-term follow-up on a very, very wide age range that is guaranteed to make age very, very predictive. But it's not evident, you know, that this entire age range is also your target population if you want to use that model in practice. So if we don't consider the right age range for our modeling and we are going to use it later in practice, then we will see that in practice the model will underperform because we investigated it in the wrong way. And this, for me, this paper is really an eye-opener in that it really does matter in which population you study your predictive ability. And that is also why in this genetic framework, disorder and setting is in the center. It really matters. For the setting, in whom are you testing the model? In whom are you going to use it? Because a test that may be very predictive in the general population is not evidently also predictive when you target more a homogeneous population because they are at increased risk because of some risk factors. You can't generalize the predictive ability from one population to the other. The really, if you study a different population, different age range, different selection of risk factors, like with triage, then you need to expect a different performance. And that also makes it so very important that we need to identify first in which population is the test going to be used, because that needs to be our study population. So that is people are using, are developing risk models in populations that may not be relevant, but also what I see a lot in polygenic risk is that they are analyzing the data in a way that I think, is this really going to be used in this way in practice? An example from, I think it's a few years ago, from a Harvard study, genetic risk score may improve the clinical identification of patients of increased risk at heart attack. So here this study claims that if you add polygenic risk score, if you consider that alongside current guidelines, 4% of the patients would be recommended statins to prevent heart attacks. But how did they get, the researchers here, get to the 4% of the additional patients? Well, what they first did is they applied in that population a clinical risk score, divided the population in three subgroups, low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk. Then in this intermediate risk, they again did a prediction based on polygenic risk and then identified a subgroup who, based on this polygenic risk score, would have had a high risk. And then they look at the people who didn't use statins, and that was 4%. So basically, first they do a clinical model, then in the intermediate group, they do a genetic model, and then they identify the people who were not using already statins. But how likely is that that is the really how we are going to apply this clinical risk score of the polygenic risk score later in practice? Why would you not add the polygenic risk score to the clinical risk score to begin with? So why would you do a worse test, what polygenic risk score often is, after you've done a better risk model first? And also, when you do it in this way, you only reclassify people up. So you only get people from the intermediate group. Of course, you get them also down, but there's only more people recommending statins, because you only here they are zooming in on the people from the intermediate group who should have been in the high group. What they don't do is the people in the high group, high risk group, that could have, you know, that could be recommended to not use statins, because with including polygenic risk, they now will have a lower risk. So this is really, if you do it stepwise like this, it's your guarantee that you will treat more patients than when you would do it in another way. And that was, so here in this paper, it's exactly the same setup. So they investigated the use of polygenic risk scores in clinical practice in two different ways. First, it's the same example as I just said, you have a population, you do a clinical risk model, you divide it in three groups. So one group, you already give the treatment. In the intermediate group, you then add the polygenic risk score, and then you have another group that you treat. This is really a scenario for treating more people. What you want to know with polygenic risk, and everybody is expecting that in the future, we all get tested. So it is no big deal to really do the polygenic risk score for everyone. And nobody is expecting that it's an unlikely scenario that will give more costs. We all assume that in the future, everybody will have their genetic data in electronic health records. So what the situation, what you need to compare is, what if I make a risk model based on clinical risk factors, or if I make a clinical risk factors and polygenic risk scores, how many people will I treat in this scenario, and will I treat more people in when I add my polygenic risk? Because when you study it in this way, then it is possible that some people with this better model will end up who were in this treatment group here, maybe in the intermediate group there, and can refrain from treatment. That is the differences in scenario between this one, you know, which is way more realistic than this one, which guaranteed lead to more treatment. And so what the researchers did when they analyzed it in this way here on the left, they found that polygenic risk score added in the prediction. And when they analyzed it here on the right, they found that it didn't add, because indeed you move some people to a higher risk category, but as many people to the intermediate risk category. And so this is what I find often so frustrating, is that that if we want to move our risk models, polygenic or clinical models, to practice, we need to investigate the scenarios that are relevant. And we also, and to ask, you know, what scenarios are there, we need to start with the clinical scenario. So the doctors, they want to have better risk models to use in practice to make better decisions. So we need to know, okay, for if you want to use it, who is your target population? Because that should be my study population. In that target population, what kind of risk factors do I have available? You know, I have my clinical risk factors, and I may have a polygenic risk score that I can add to that. I need to know, for the decisions that you make, what is your time frame that people are interested in? Is it a 5-year risk? Is it a 10-year risk? What we now often see is that you get a 6.8-year risk or 12.2-year risk simply because that was the follow-up time available in the study. But that is not how our predictions will be used. So we need to know what time period is relevant for the decisions that need to be made, and what's the outcome that we are interested in, because sometimes it is the risk of disease, sometimes it is something else, the risk of serious disease, something is. We need to know what the doctors and the patients find important, and then you make a prediction model. Because if we don't do it in this way, and you don't need to do it in this way, but I think that this is most sensible, we are spending just a lot of time creating models that nobody will use in practice. And so to decide for which diseases, you know, it is worth thinking about this, I read this paper also early on by my colleague Moeen Khoury here in Atlanta, who wrote a paper about, you know, just reminding us that, you know, when you make a risk model, or when you do genetic discoveries, he starts even one phase earlier, the ultimate goal is to have population health impact. And so based on the genes that you discover in what he calls the translation phase one, so you have variants out there that are associated with your disease of interest, you want to change that into to guidelines, you know, you want to change that, translate that into an application, that application needs to be changed in practice, and then we need to measure population health impact in practice. It is this what always follows the introduction, and so from that you can also reason back, let me do that here. If you want to do, this is the typical framework that people use for the analysis, for the evaluation of applications of testing in screening. So the overall goal, if you apply a screening test in the general population, the overall goal is to improve outcomes here at the end. But that's what we never can, you know, would recommend. That would need a very, very big study to investigate that long-term follow-up. So basically they break down the question. So first you need to have, in the general population, you need to have a test that can reliably establish the risk factors. That's the analytic validity that needs to predict to a certain degree. And then you apply your interventions so that you have a reduction in morbidity and mortality. If you think ahead that that is ultimately what you need to deliver, you know, with your prediction model, you can also think ahead, you know, if I want to have a certain health impact at the end, how strong does the predictive ability of my model need to be able to have that effect later on? Too often these days, we see that researchers say that the model predicts when basically the area under the curve is statistically significant, or whether there is a significant improvement, or there is, in my field at least, also a statistically significant standard deviation of the polygenic risk score. But that is not the bar. You know, if you don't have expectations in the beginning how predictive a model needs to be, then everything will be get the conclusion of being promising, being predictive, because we build our models on variants that are associated. So simply finding that the area under the curve is significant is no big deal. It's no surprise, because the area under the curve is simply a different way of, you know, in the essence of quantifying an association. So if the ingredients of a risk model are associated, then we expect the score to be associated, then we expect the area under the curve to go up. And if you don't have an expectation on how high the area under the curve needs to be, whether it needs to be 0.60, 0.75, then everything you conclude is going to be predictive. But everything that you move forward with will not lead to enough reduction of morbidity and mortality. So that is why I often want to look ahead. You know, if you want to change healthcare, improve the health of the individuals, how strong does my area under the curve need to be? I do not know exactly how strong that is and how to compute that. But you know, for many applications, that is why I often say if the area under the curve is below 0.60, it's very unlikely to have a big benefit at the end. And then I get criticized for judging utility on the AUC. I get that, but this is how I triage the applications that I'm interested in. So then we need to go, okay, another thing to think about it is how predictable are diseases and traits, you know, so we make those prediction models, but we often face that our prediction models are not so very, very predictive. And this is, especially when we look at genetics, I think our biggest problem with predicting diseases and traits is the complexity of those diseases. So even here, not that these are my favorite examples, but they are very helpful for illustration. Here you see crashed planes and you see capsized ships. You know, the phenotype, what we see is the same, but nobody believes that these crashed for the same reasons. And that's the same also with complex diseases that we'll show in a minute. For genetics, it's also, because it's so very complex, a genetic test can never predict the disease quite well when the heritability of the disease or trait is in the lower ranges. So a genetic test potentially in the future, if we totally understand how, for example, the genes implicate in type 2 diabetes, type 1 diabetes or schizophrenia, that heritability, the contribution of genetics to the development of disease is so high that, you know, we may predict that disease, the onset of it, you know, to identify people at high risk based on genetics. But for other diseases, especially where the type 2 diabetes and lung cancer, where the behavioral factors are so very important, even the best genetic tests will never make a big deal because the environment matters so much. And so that adds to the complexity too. And so I often like to compare complex diseases with complex events, because these complex disasters, they illustrate actively. So this is an example from disaster management. I got a message that my connection is unstable, so I repeat my last sentence. This is in disaster management. So in 1987 in Belgium, the Herald of Free Enterprise capsized in front of the coast of Belgium. And because that was such an unlikely event to happen, because it's generally when you cross to the UK, it's a calm sea, it's not an ocean, stormy ocean, it's just calm. And there was nothing apparent that could foresee that this ship would capsize. So it became a case study for disaster management, and researchers analyzed why this ship could capsize, and what they basically concluded that it was a combination of factors. You know, there were doors open, the ship was low on the water because there was, you know, to get with high and low tide the cars on a ferry, you need to lower the ship or you need to raise it. The ship was low on the water, they were sailing harder than normally, so they were creating higher waves, and so these higher waves could enter the ship because the ship was low on the water and the doors were open. And so if you take the full story of this disaster, they analyzed that it was very likely that the ship capsized at days because it was a combination of 13 factors that happened approximately at the same time or in the right order, that they said, okay, then inevitably, because these things are happening, you know, it was about to, it was inevitable. They cannot prove it, of course, and they should not try, but that is how they reasoned it. But here is what is then, if you know how this ship capsized on that day, what is the value for predicting future disasters? Well, the value of this detailed model is very, very small, because it's very unlikely that a future ship will capsize through the exact same combination of factors that happened here. What we can do, and what we to prevent future disasters, is to analyze a lot of disasters like this and then identify the common factors in all those causes. And that's also exactly what we do in epidemiology when we study diseases. Complex diseases, we cannot say, you know, that someone got a heart attack because of this unique combination of risk factors, but we can analyze what are the most common risk factors in those diseases and then intervene on those. But if the origin of diseases is so complex, then it becomes very, very difficult to make good models. And so, because the quality of a prediction model, so how well a model can predict disease, is based on the quality of data and based on the quality of the model. We can only predict diseases quite well if we have good data and we have a good model that represents how people get ill. And this is how in genetics, I think people get way too over-optimistic about our opportunities, is because they only focus on the DNA data, that it can be so accurate and cheap and reliably assessed in the future. So basically the analytic validity, the quality of the data will be very good. Though when I give the same talk to people who are working on this technology, they are way more pessimistic than I am, but I assume that this is very good. But then when, you know, your diseases are not entirely based on genetics, then you have to measure and the environment as well. How do you know how to, as you know, to include the quality of a diet in your model? What are the relevant factors? That is already, and so how much before the onset of disease that you do not know the onset, so you do not know when you should measure it. It's very, very complicated to really reliably and make relevant assessments of the diet and other non-genetic factors. And then alone the modeling. If every patient, you know, likely, at least in my view, has a different combination of causes that made them ill, then there is no general model, you know, that we can use to predict how all the people get ill. Everybody likely has their own model. And that is, I think, why, you know, prediction will be very hard, because this is so hard to measure and this is so difficult to model. And this is how I summarize the predictive ability and also the future potential in genetics. Huh? And I will translate it to non-genetics in a minute. So when we think about, you know, what diseases can be predicted better than others, it depends largely on two factors: the complexity of the causes and the heritability. How, you know, to what extent do the genetics contribute to the onset of disease? And when the heritability is high and the genetics is simple, which is in the field of monogenic diseases, where really when it's one mutation that causes someone to get ill or not get ill, you can very well predict who will get ill in the future. And even for familial breast cancer, even for colorectal cancer. But if the heritability is low, so when the environment and the non-genetic factors play a big role, then basically it is not genetic enough to really get a model with very high predictive ability. But when the heritability is high, when it's very genetic disease, like for example, or a trait like height, but there are so many variants involved that it's maybe too complex to model, and that also reduces the predictive ability of models. And these two factors do not only apply to genetics, it also basically the complexity also holds for complex diseases in general, where it's a combination, I think it's even more complex than that, between genetic factors and the environment. And then here the explained variance is the you know, all your predictors together, what proportion do they explain of the variance in the phenotype. So when that is low and it is too complex, then it will just be very, very hard to make a model better. But also when it is, you know, you potentially, you know, the variables that you have available explain a lot of the variance, then it may not always not be easy to model it accurately. And so that is also why, you know, I really like this quote from Barabasi, like now we are close to knowing about everything there is about the pieces, you know, about those genes, but we are as far as we have ever been from understanding nature as a whole. Indeed, the reassembly turned out to be much harder than scientists anticipated. The reason is simple. Riding reductionism, so identifying one risk factor after the other, we now run into the hard wall of complexity. If you want to combine all the information we have so far, you know, to combine it again into prediction models, we face the complexity and that make it difficult to predict some diseases very, very well. So we do have those many scientific breakthroughs, at least they are claimed, but underlying it, I think the studies of these days still have a lot of the shortcomings as they had decades ago. Too often, at least in my field, we don't see calibration, we don't see external validation, we don't see if they make a comparison with clinical risk models, it's just what they made up in the studies, not really you know, what is already out there and being used. If people make risk thresholds in their analysis, it's often not based on clinical relevance, but doctors would consider a lot of time just based on thresholding in the data itself. And we rarely see, if ever, I still need to see the first paper that is doing a great job on this, that there's a consideration of the intended use before starting to design the study. So very often, and this is just one line, I didn't put a citation here, but one line of how little people have an idea about what will be done with the risk models. You often see those empty quotes in articles. Such comprehensive risk models will facilitate the clinical decision-making and help management for at-risk women and provide more personalized risk management. That is really a quote you can use for everything and everywhere without saying anything that really shows that the findings under study really improve care. So in moving forward, I think, you know, if we want to have a greater chance in getting our work implemented in healthcare, we need to think ahead and study applications where a prediction model can achieve the discriminative accuracy needed for implementation in healthcare. So the discriminative accuracy, the AUC, is not the end, it's just the beginning, but you know, without it, you're maybe betting on the wrong horses. If we do so, if you find applications that are worth it, then you need to design your study with the intended use in mind. So you need to choose the right study population, a relevant risk period, using available predictors for that population. What we see too often, and so I don't recommend doing that, is don't use available data sets. Only use them if the data are relevant, can really provide evidence for clinical care. Compare them with existing non-genetic models that are being used as a benchmark for comparison, and then interpret the findings in the context of the intended use, not based on statistical significance alone. Because ultimately, you need to decide whether the model is predictive enough, not that it's statistically associated, but predictive enough, actionable, and affordable. And also just, I can't say this enough, highest area on the curve. We see that a lot in polygenic risk research where people compare models and then select the one with the highest AUC. That is not the goal. Utility is the goal. And AUC on its own does not tell it's not a guarantee for utility. Prediction models, they need to make a difference in the health of and lives of people. And for that, we need to make our research, I think, more relevant. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much for this very clear talk. Very, very, I think, thought-provoking and really asking us all to question a lot of the work that we've read and consumed also in the news media. So I'm just going to stop the recording here and then we'll open up the discussions.